Good morning and welcome to the 31st meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2023. I welcome Jim Felly, who's come here as a substitute, and I believe Sarah Boyett's going to be attending the meeting at some stage. Agenda item one is a decision in taking business in private, and we have considerations whether to take items 6, 7 and 8 in private. Item 6 is to consider a draft letter on our pre-budget scrutiny. Items 7 and 8 are to consider the evidence we will hear today under items 4 and 5. Do we agree to take these items in private? We are agreed. Our next item of business then is agenda item 2, is the consideration of a draft statutory instrument, the Heat Network Supply Target Scotland Regulations 2023. And I'm pleased to welcome Patrick Harvey, the Minister for Net Zero Carbon Buildings, Active Travel and Tenants' Rights. And I also welcome James Hemphill, the Head of Heat Networks Policy Unit for the Scottish Government. And I'm probably going to get this wrong, but I'll try hard. Suzanne Lemire, I hope I've got that right. Good. Of Heat Networks Policy Team, Scottish Government. Thank you for joining us today. The instrument is laid under the affirmative procedure, which means it cannot come into force unless the Parliament approve it. Following this evidence session, the committee will be invited at the next agenda item to consider a motion for the committee to recommend the instrument be approved. I remind everyone that officials can speak under this item, but not in the debate that follows. I believe, Minister, you want to make a brief opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener, and my sincere apologies for the short delay. That's more than I got from the train announcement as we were held outside Waverley, but I'm sorry to take a few minutes longer than expected to get here. I'm grateful for the chance to speak to this instrument. It supports our ambition to grow the number and scale of heat networks in Scotland. And I know that it's widely recognised that heat networks should and will be an increasingly significant part of our transition from fossil fuels for heating our homes, workplaces and buildings to clean heat. The Heat Networks Act of 2021 requires that we set a target for 2035. But as well as that requirement, this target is in and of itself useful. It'll send a clear signal to the heat network sector that this government and indeed future Scottish governments are committed to the growth of heat networks. The proposed target of 7 terawatt hours is one of the three options that we propose in our consultation. Each of those was evidence-based, developed using data from the First National Assessment of Potential Heat Network Zones report. But as we set out in the government's response to that consultation, the data that we have about the sector is limited at the moment. We have to continue to use the powers that we have in the Act to obtain more and more accurate and reliable information so that we can report on the progress that we're making against all the statutory targets. Recognising this, the government response also committed to keeping this and other targets under review as further evidence emerges on the potential for heat networks across Scotland, for example, as local authorities produce their local heat and energy efficiency strategies. Setting this target is just one of the things that we're doing to help grow the sector. There's a range of other concerted actions that we're taking to meet the targets that have been set and that we're proposing now to allow the heat network sector to flourish. We're resourcing and providing technical support to local authorities to develop their LHEs, which are identifying opportunities across Scotland for heat network development. In February 2022, we launched the Heat Network Support Unit, which is providing skills, capacity and other resources to local authorities to help them through the pre-capital stages of heat network development. And we've launched Scotland's Heat Networks Fund, which makes £300 million available to large-scale district and communal heating projects across Scotland. In May this year, we also commenced legislation which requires Scottish public buildings to produce building assessment reports as soon as practical. Collectively, these actions will help us to achieve our proposed target and increase the likelihood that consumers will want to connect into heat networks. Based on the analytics we've done, in combination with the broad support that we received in response to the consultation, I'm very happy to be here to move the motion and ask the committee to agree to set a new target for heat network deployment in Scotland of at least 7 terawatt hours by 2035. Thank you very much, Convener.
Thank you very much, Minister. I've got some questions, if I may, to start with. I think we're, according to the information currently producing about 1.18 terawatt hours of heat through this means. What are the targets to get us to 2035, i.e. the 7 terawatt hours that you're looking to achieve?
Well, as we set out in the consultation, we derived the three proposed targets based on not only the information from the first assessment report looking at where heat network zones will be, but also on a range of scenarios about the viability of heat networks. A high and low scenario means that you might see more or fewer heat networks come forward in those areas that have been found to be suitable for them, and then assumptions about a 50% connection rate. As we go forward, we're going to have to address some of the issues around demand assurance so that those developing and investing in heat networks have confidence that there will be consumers connecting to them. But we made that 50% assumption in the short period ahead before those demand assurance measures are in place. So those three factors would what derive the three proposals of 6, 7 and was it 12 and a half was the other stretch target, if you like. And I think, you know, while a case can be made for any of them, I think it was felt pretty clearly that the 7 terawatt hours target was both stretching in terms of significant growth within the sector, but also achievable.
So what are the targets between now and 2035? That's the question I asked.
Well, the Act...
Or do you just go to seven terawatt hours by 2035?
The Act sets the initial targets. The new target that we're setting is for 2035. We don't have annual targets in between those.
And in the specific targets that the Act sets are 2.6 terawatt hours to 2027 and then 6 terawatt hours to 2030. And one of the other things that we considered when looking at, as part of the consultation, was the advice from the Committee on Climate, the Climate Change Committee, then the Committee on Climate Change, that UK should be looking to achieve around 20% of the heat demand through heat networks.
You're effectively got to more than double what we're doing at the moment in 3 years. Is that achievable?
Well, those are the existing targets under the Act. The 2035 target is for what goes beyond that.
That might well be what goes beyond the current one, but the target at the moment, I've just been told by Suzanne, is 2.6 by 2027. So I'm asking, is it possible to double what we're producing at the moment in less than 3 years?
Yeah, I mean, the committee in the previous session debated the targets that should be set in the Act in the last session of Parliament. I think the 2030 target was a result of a committee amendment rather than a government proposal at the time. But I think the Climate Change Committee view, as the independent advisor, is that the 2030 target is a bit of a stretch target. It's a bit of an outlier. We are committed to doing everything that we can to meet it. And that includes the very range of actions that we've set out, including the Heat Network Support Unit, the Heat Network Fund, and trying to help make sure that heat networks that come forward are investable propositions, that they're attractive for non-government investors as well. So, yeah, the range of actions that we're taking already in order to meet the initial targets that were set under the Act, I've set out. What we're proposing today is the 2035 target, and the Act does require us to set a 2035 target.
I completely understand that. I'm trying to work out in my brain whether the 2035 target that you put forward is remotely achievable.
We believe that it is.
OK, so what's it going to cost?
The overall investment will come partly from public funds and partly from institutional investors.
Okay.
Heat networks, of course, unlike something like decarbonisation through energy efficiency, generate a revenue stream, and that makes them potentially attractive for institutional investors. You know, it's not possible at this point to produce an individual costing for every network that will be built between now and 2035. That's why local authorities are undertaking the local heat and energy efficiency strategies in order to identify the most likely sites. An area like Glasgow, for example, has huge potential for heat networks. probably significantly more than some less densely built parts of the country. But it will be for them to take forward individual propositions for specific networks.
So you're setting a target before they've reported, the local councils, and without a clear idea of what this will cost?
As I've said, the Act requires us to set a 2035 target. That's what we're doing, to comply with the Act. But we believe setting the target is helpful in itself as the clear signal to the sector. You know, it's a little bit like the wider heat in buildings agenda that we've been discussing recently and on which we'll consult shortly. The setting of a clear direction of travel by government is the clear signal that industry needs, that Scotland is serious about getting this work done, and that indeed is what can focus not only minds but investment capacity in order to achieve those targets. In many ways, that's what happened with renewable electricity generation. Scotland, successive Scottish governments set a very clear direction of travel, very clear market signals that Scotland was serious about renewable electricity. If we hadn't done that, then setting targets alone wouldn't have been possible. But by the range of actions that I've set out, Scotland, I think, is demonstrating not only the will, but the focus necessary to achieve the targets that we're setting today.
OK, I'm going to go to the next question, but just an observation that if people see there's an aspirational direction of travel, it might inspire them to do it. But at the end of the day, if they don't see a return for the capital that they've got invested in the project, you could set the target whatever you like. You could make it as aspirational as you like, but it won't necessarily mean very much. And what I've not heard, Minister, from you is giving me confidence that the seven terawatt hours is achievable. That's my concern. Sorry, Mark, I'll come to you and then anyone else.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I mean, very much welcome a target being brought forward for 2035. I think it was maybe on the back of one of my amendments yes, James is nodding there, one of my amendments to the Heat Networks Bill, that the provision to set a 2035 target was put into the bill. Although I remember at the time it was difficult to actually put a figure on that, and there was, you know, a lot of discussion with the Minister at the time about that. So good to see an actual figure coming forward and the actual work being done to construct a figure. Can I ask then how that relates to the LHEs? Because it appears that the LHEs are on track. There's been a lot of very granular work being done at local authorities to work out exactly where district heating schemes can be put in place. Do we have enough of a picture now through that work that's been done by 32 local authorities to really, you know, build out that certainty that industry wants and to enable us to peg a target to 2035, which is obviously still some way off?
I think it is developing. As I mentioned, some local authorities are further ahead than others. Some have higher heat network potential than others. Glasgow was, I think, earlier in the process. Was already beginning to take forward some of the work on LHEs. I think before it was a legal requirement, they'd already begun to undertake that work, and it's clearly one of the areas that has very significant potential for heat networks, which is, you know, necessary given that there's a high density of homes that will be difficult to decarbonise in other ways. So the picture that's emerging, local authority by local authority, and I think a significant number have completed their LHEs and others are due to complete that work by the end of the year, I think does demonstrate that we have a handle on where heat networks are likely to be coming forward, as well as, just to address once again the Convener's concern, the confidence of knowing that they will generate a return on investment. These are developments that will generate an income stream, and that is one of the things that will make them attractive for investment.
And do you still see opportunities for municipal ownership of heat networks? Is that a model that could flourish?
Yeah, we've been exploring a range of different models of operation. That may involve direct municipal ownership. It may involve joint ventures between local authorities and other partners. I think the opportunity exists not only to ensure that the heat decarbonisation is achievable for people, that householders and businesses feel that there is a service that's going to be available to them, that it's going to provide them with long-term certainty about the consumer protection that's being built in, about low-carbon and affordable heat, but also that they have trust that it's being operated to a large extent in the public interest. I think if you look at the experience of a country like Denmark, which have been advising us, as I think Mark Ruskell knows, for a number of years on the development of the Act and the implementation of it, very generously sharing their expertise. They've been doing this for 50 years. They're still rolling out heat networks because the third of the country or so that doesn't yet have access to them has a high demand. They want to be connected because they know more than ever in a cost of living crisis that that's the affordable way to meet their heating needs. They know that the operation of those systems in the public interest is something that the public has a high degree of trust in. If we can emulate that in as much of Scotland as possible, then we'll not only achieve that decarbonisation, not only do it affordably, but also hopefully achieve the same degree of high public trust that our neighbours in Denmark have achieved. Mm.
Yep. Okay.
Thanks, Mark. Douglas and Jim, did you want in? Okay, Douglas first, then
thanks,
Jim.
Thanks, Convener. And Minister, I'm a big fan of heat networks. And but it's back to the Convener's point. Setting a target is one thing. When do we actually see a plan of how we're going to actually achieve that? And also, as you mentioned, you know, it might be easier in places like Glasgow, but then we have rural areas and rural local authorities. Can you give us assurance that they are not going to be penalised for maybe not moving forward as quickly as everyone else, because it's obviously a lot harder to do a rural area than a place like Glasgow?
Yes, I mean, the range of networks that exist at the moment, some of them district networks serving multiple buildings, others communal networks serving multiple customers within a single building, they do exist in a range of urban and rural settings, including some island communities as well. I think it's very clear that there will be high level of potential in dense urban environments like Glasgow. That should in no way inhibit the development of networks where they're the most suitable approach to decarbonisation in other parts of Scotland. And that's why we're asking each local authority to lead on the development of the LHEs that are under development at the moment. I think it would be wrong, for example, if central government did this and simply decided we're going to decide what's appropriate in each local area. That's why local leadership is so necessary in achieving this.
So what's the next steps then, Minister? Is there going to be an overall plan that's going to come back? And you know, when should we start seeing money in the government's capital plan, for example, to assist with some of these heat networks?
Well, as I mentioned in my opening remarks, we already have the Heat Network Support Fund, the Support Unit and Heat Network Fund, which is providing the Support Unit pre-capital support and the fund itself capital support. The question about when is, you know, it's already happening. Local authorities are producing their LHEs. We've some time ago completed the first national assessment report. The local work that's developing LHEs is coming in local authority by local authority. I think they're all expected due in by the end of the year. And so I think the picture that's already emerging is going to continue to develop. And we have other powers in the Act, of course, to continue to improve data collection on a richer understanding of the heat networks that are in development and in operation.
So would you expect an overall plan from all these local authorities to be then presented back to Parliament so we can get assurance that the target for 35 is going to be met? And what would happen if that target isn't met? Is there anything? What happens?
Each local authority produces their LHEs and provides that to government. I think they're all to be provided to the committee as well. They'll all be made public.
They'll all be made public. We think we've got six or seven out to draft at the minute, which is good progress. We are also undertaking an independent collation of those 32 strategies so that we've got something that we can go out and present to the likes of yourselves and others with an interest, which I guess maps those opportunity areas across the country, gives us an aggregate total, you know, some. And I would say here, based on some of the drafts that we've seen so far, I think local authorities are quite rightly applying some stringent scenarios and some less stringent scenarios. So we will see quite a range in the potential. And then just on your point, just to go back to that collation work should complete next year, and I'm sure we'll be able to share that with committee. The other thing that we
do have and will have to do again. We published the heat network delivery plan we were required to do under the Act. Again, I think it was your own amendment, Mr. Russell. So we published that in March 2022, and we're under a duty to review that and report on progress every 2 years, as well as the impact that our own policies and programmes have had, and to keep that continually updated every 2 years.
So just following up, every 2 years, so when would be the first one at so time would come back?
The review will be March 2024. I think we'll need to speak to clerks about where that goes to, but presumably it will be to yourselves to review that.
And can I just check the other question I raised about not meeting targets? Is local authorities going to be set targets as well, or is it just an overall target?
Yeah, it's a national target, yeah.
And if that's not met, any...
Well, the Act does allow us to continue to review the target, and I would think it's at least a fair possibility that we'll be reviewing the target upwards rather than downwards. But if at some point in the future a future government decides that heat networks have not been the success that I believe they will be, it would be for a future government to come back to committee, back to Parliament, and ask to review the target in the other direction. I think there's a stronger likelihood that we might see greater progress on this, and I think we should be throwing our weight behind the development of heat networks as one of the most effective ways to decarbonise Scotland.
Mm-hmm. And you mentioned institutional investors. Can you give us any more details on what discussions have been held so far and how likely that is to take place?
Yeah, there's a range of discussions that have taken place, not only with individual potential investors. The Scottish Government has an investor panel that advises it, but also through the Green Heat Finance Task Force, which, as you know, has been meeting for some significant time now, and its first report will be due out very soon, alongside the eminent consultation on the heat and buildings proposals more generally. I think the expectation is that the first phase of that task force report will focus on individual approaches, and the second phase report will look at the more communal area-based approaches, which might include greater focus on heat networks. But yeah, there's a significant amount of work happening in that area.
And I guess there must be a lot of regulation that would go on behind the scenes as well, because I would imagine if you had a heat network, whether you want competition or not, whether there's, basically so you don't get somebody just increasing the prices to a huge amount. There must be a huge amount of work that would have to go behind that in legislation to make sure that it works for everyone.
Yes, I mean, the legislation that was passed in the last session of the Scottish Parliament to get this work underway, that was done before we knew that the UK Energy Act was coming. So we've taken account of some of the changes that took place in that. There were some areas where you'd be very pleased to know the Scottish and UK governments were able to work together on useful changes to that energy legislation. In particular, it deals with some of the consumer protection issues. But there are some other changes as well which require us to reconsider perhaps some aspects of how we approach the implementation of the Scottish Heat Networks Act. In light of the UK legislative changes, we'll consider, for example, our approach to permitting and consenting, and make sure that we've got the balance right. Over the course of time, there will no doubt be other legislative changes. I think one of the critical things that we're still awaiting from the UK government is a rebalancing of electricity and gas prices. Whether the current UK government makes good on that commitment or has to wait for a successor government, we know that that's one of the critical things that will spur not only the viability of decarbonisation of heat, but also the attractiveness of it. So, for example, as we decarbonise existing heat networks, some of them will shift over to using such devices such as heat pumps as one of their energy sources. If those are using electricity rather than using gas, that's great to decarbonise those existing networks. But the rebalancing of prices is going to be one of the things that's critical to making that viable and attractive for customers.
And as yet, you're open to whether that's private companies putting in heat networks or whether it's local authorities running the heat networks, that's still up in the air.
As I said, we've been exploring a number of different models for the development and operation. We think it will be an attractive area for private investment, but we also know that there's a need for the public sector to give leadership, particularly at local level, where local authorities understand both the building stock and the energy resources that they can bring to bear. That's why they're leading on the development of LHEs. And as I said, we've looked at a range of models, including direct municipal ownership and joint ventures.
Okay, thanks, Camino.
Thanks, Douglas. Jim, you want us to come in?
I'll try and be very quick, Minister. And if I ask daft laddie questions, I do apologise. I'm just catching up with what this is. Some of the briefing papers here, it says the strategies will identify potential heating system changes that may occur in a local area following extensive analysis and consultation. I'm going to lead on to where Douglas Lumsden was a minute ago, but I want to just get clear in my head. How is this heat actually going to be used? How do you physically get it into the consumer?
I would encourage the member and others in the committee, if they haven't taken the chance to visit some of the heat networks that are already in operation, others that are being expanded or redeveloped. Essentially, these are highly insulated pipes that go under the ground, coming from a central heat source. Now, that might be the generation of heat deliberately for the network. It might be a waste heat source. There are industrial waste heat sources where we're letting that valuable warmth just go to waste at the moment. Heat networks can bring that to the consumer. So an individual business or household wouldn't need to have their own boiler, except potentially as an emergency backup. They might choose to have something in reserve, but their main heating and, in some circumstances, potentially cooling needs would be met via the network.
So, if I've got this right, you're effectively pumping heat into a building.
Yes.
Via a pipe network. That will have to be paid for, the heat that is being distributed into that property.
Correct.
So, that kind of generates a
revenue stream for the network, which is what makes it an attractive proposition for investors. The experience of heat networks in this country, and I think in Denmark as well, where they're most extensive of any European country, is that they do tend to be affordable and attractive for that reason, compared with individual consumption of gas or other fuels.
I do apologise, Convener. That then leads me to the regulatory side of energy. Will you foresee yourself coming up against the UK government in terms of how you regulate the price of that heat going into properties?
Well, the aspiration is always to try and work together on issues which are set between devolved and reserved powers. Sometimes we're more successful at achieving that cooperation than at other times. As I mentioned, some of the changes that took place to the Energy Act at Westminster recently were agreeable, and we made good progress on some of those issues. Not necessarily everything, but we'll continue to do that. My preference, of course, would be that we were able to make those regulatory changes here in Scotland. We have to work with the situation that we're in as we continue to, as the member knows, make the case for Scotland at some point taking those powers to itself. But that certainly shouldn't prevent us from rolling out heat networks urgently, because they are one of the most obvious ways to decarbonise Scotland, particularly urban Scotland.
But there are things that we would need to negotiate going forward, but we don't stop going forward on the basis that we hope that we'll find agreement.
Yeah, and the appointment of Ofgem as the regulator is one example of that. We need to ensure that there's consumer protection, and the appointment of Ofgem in that that capacity will help to achieve that.
Okay, one very final question, Convener. Going back to the point that the Convener was talking about earlier on, how you go from, I think it's 1.5 terawatt-hours at the moment, 1.6 terawatt-hours just now, to 7 terawatt-hours in 2035, will that not require a huge workforce to be able to actually modify and change the existing infrastructure that we have? Do we have that workforce, and do we have the skill base?
Yeah, I mean, that's a question that's relevant to the whole heat and buildings agenda. We know that we need to scale up and skill up. I've been working closely with Mr. Day on the skills and education side of things. The supply chain delivery plan is also working with those voices from within industry who see this as an opportunity. And I genuinely think there's a huge potential for us to see this as an economic opportunity for Scotland. There's work to be had. There's high-quality careers to be had doing this work. decarbonising, not just between now and 2045, but out beyond that as well in maintaining and operating those systems. I think James just wanted to come in on your previous point as well.
It was just on the work with the UK government. So we do have colleagues who join the various forums that UK government colleagues have in designing these consumer and technical standards. So we do have a route into to informing that. And then the other thing I was just going to say on the current question is, just to add to what the Minister says, we do know that we have, you know, some of the big energy companies that we have here in Scotland at the minute are getting increasingly, and some are actively involved in heat networks at the minute and are increasingly interested in it. So we know that there's interest there.
Thank you.
There are some other questions. I've just got one quick one. And you've made the point, Minister, that it is used in Denmark and it's very attractive in Glasgow. We're talking about, in most cases in Denmark and Glasgow, urban conurbations or larger conurbations. The biggest price for heat pumps is surely the piping and the insulating of the piping. In rural areas where houses are spread out, is it ever going to become attractive?
I think it will depend on the specific settings of each area, and that's why these LHEs are being taken forward at a local level. I mean, if the committee hasn't had the chance to learn about the heat network in Shetland, for example, I think that would be instructive. It's been in operation for 25 years, and they're now looking to expand and extend it, including to potential customers who are not right in the town centre. So, yeah, I mean, there are some energy losses that come from extensive heat networks, but the experience of Denmark is that you can do this over a very wide area. It's not just in the inner core of a city where this has value, and so we'd like to make sure that as many parts of Scotland that can benefit from heat networks will do so. Of course, in less densely populated areas, other approaches to decarbonisation, including individual heat pumps and other technologies, will be and already are extremely successful.
And I will avoid the temptation to talk about heat pumps in old houses. Douglas, you want to ask a question?
Yep.
And I'm going to go to Monica. And if there's no other questions from the committee, I'll go to Sarah.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Just to come back in, Minister, you mentioned boilers, gas boilers being used as an emergency backup, potentially. So do you still feel that there's going to be a market and a demand for gas boilers going forward, even though people would maybe be part of a heat network?
Well, the proposals that we're about to consult on heat in buildings do set out how the heat standard will work and recognise that fossil fuel systems for emergency backup might continue to be necessary. I think it's probably more likely that those would be your portable systems rather than an installed gas boiler. The opportunity is to make sure that the vast majority of the heat that's consumed is coming from sustainable sources, is non-polluting, and I think the opportunity is also to ensure that we can achieve that in a way that's consistent with affordability, tackling fuel poverty, and other objectives.
So the potential ban on gas boilers, so would that then be relaxed for emergency backup purposes, or how would that work?
As I said, we'll be consulting on the wider heat and buildings proposals very soon, so the detail will be published in that. It doesn't affect the setting of the target for heat networks.
But the potential ban on gas boilers, I can't remember the year that the Scottish Government was saying that then, is that going to be met or not?
Sorry,
Douglas, that's slightly off the topic. I'm sure I'd encourage the Minister to respond to you afterwards on a separate subject, but I want to try and keep on the instrument that we're looking at. So I think you've pushed that as far as you can at the moment. Monica.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister and your officials. Just a brief question from me. In terms of meeting these important targets that have been set, can you clarify what role energy from waste facilities will have? How, for example, how dependent?
I didn't quite catch that. Sorry.
Oh, sorry. Just check my mic's on properly. Yeah, in terms of the targets that have been set, how reliant will government be on the existing use of energy from waste facilities, incinerators? Just to clarify what contribution they will make to the achievement of the targets?
Yeah, I mean, the use of waste heat from any source, if it's a facility that already exists, I see no reason why we shouldn't be using waste heat from a facility that already exists. That's a resource that at the moment is going to waste. Separately, you know, quite unconnected to the specific policy of heat network targets, obviously the government has an approach on incineration which wants to move away from the development of new incinerators. But any source of waste heat from an existing facility, whether it's an energy from waste plant, whether it's a data centre, whether it's an industrial site, I think is a valuable contribution to putting heat onto a heat network.
Okay. No, that's helpful. And again, good to hear about the moratorium proposal on incineration. What I wanted to ask around that is, we've obviously got the circular economy bill, so we want to see a reduction in consumption overall. If some of these existing facilities become less viable and less feasible as business opportunities and they start to close down or decommission early, would that have an impact on your targets?
Heat networks are particularly viable and effective when they have a range of different heat consumers, you know, not all domestic, but some commercial, some industrial, large public buildings, for example, and also a range of heat sources. There will be some networks that have a very heavy reliance on a single or a very small number of heat sources. Those existing networks will be under a duty to bring forward a plan to decarbonise if they have a polluting heat source. But I think over time, and as we see the development of heat networks on an extensive basis, we're likely to see that viability, mm-hmm. an incentive for any operator to diversify their heat sources. That might be banks of heat pumps. It might be using particularly in area like Glasgow, it might be using, as Queen's Quay does, the River Clyde as a heat source, but would also include potentially industrial uses, industrial sources of heat, waste heat, and other options. And I think that diversification of both heat producers and heat consumers is one of the things that will make those networks more viable for the long term.
Thank you.
Okay. Jim, very quickly, and then I'm going to go to Sarah, and then we're going to move on to the next item of business.
It's going back to the point, and I'm sorry, questions keep getting sparked by other people asking questions. Monica is asking about energy from waste, and there is a presumption against building any new incinerator plants. I think I'm also right in saying that there is a ban on municipal waste for landfill. Is there not value in continuing to get better technology into incinerator plants if we're going to develop these energy from waste systems?
I mean, I think that's probably a question that's best directed at colleagues who work on the waste side. Mm. There are many reasons why there's an environmental desire to move away from burning our waste, to put it simply, even with modern technology. Essentially requires, as I think Monica Lennon's question was hinting at, it essentially requires a continual feed of waste material going into it, and it's not consistent with a circular economy approach. But the approach on heat networks is to say, where you have an existing facility that's got waste heat that's going into the air that's not benefiting anyone, you might as well plug that into a heat network and actually get some yep. value and some use out of it.
Yeah, absolute value in that. I completely agree. And we do want to move to a circular economy. But that doesn't mean to say that we're going to be, are we genuinely going to reduce the amount of waste where we don't need landfill, where we don't need, we're still going to have waste and probably considerable amounts of it.
You're stretching that, Mr. Fairley, but I mean, if you want to answer that briefly, Minister.
And it's not a trick question, it's just
No. I'm sure it's a sincere question, but I think it is one for colleagues whose remit and portfolio is around circular economy and waste management, rather than necessarily one that's about the setting of a heat network target.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Sarah.
Thanks very much, Convener. It's a question about accountability and consumer protection, because we are getting heat networks developed. I've visited ones in Clydebank, Midlothian, where they're partly owned by the council, they're owned by the council, but operated through a private partnership approach. So there's accountability for the residents. In Edinburgh, by contrast, we've got dozens of heat networks, and they're not run by the council, but they're also not for residential properties as a rule. So as you roll out this approach, there's a critical issue here about accountability and consumer protection, not just in the short term, but when the source of energy shifts. Again, you need that accountability in terms of the costings. So how is that feeding into these regulations in terms of consumer protection? It kind of goes back to Mark Ruskell's initial point about municipal ownership, because councils are absolutely critical to the planning process, joining up in terms of housing, whether it's new or old. As you say, they've got the knowledge. Isn't there an accountability issue here that we should actually be focusing on those council leadership approaches? And if there's public-private approach, then you've got accountability rather than just going down a private route that you've mentioned?
Say, I'm absolutely interested in the answer. The problem is we're talking about setting a target of 7 terawatt hours by 2035. So I'd be delighted if the Minister would respond briefly to that and shape it as much as you can to the target that you're hoping to set, Minister.
I would like to see ambition coming from local authorities and from other bodies, for example, social landlords, who would see connection to a heat network as something that's in the interest of their tenants and the interest of their business model as well. And I think if we do see that level of ambition coming from public bodies, including local authorities, that will contribute very substantially to meeting the 7 terawatt hour target. I think some of the consumer protection issues that Sarah Boyack quite rightly raises, as we're all aware, those are reserved. But the recent legislation and the appointment of Ofgem in its role goes a significant way toward addressing those issues. I very much wish that we were able to legislate for those matters here. As things stand, we're not, and we need to work with the UK government, and that's what we've been doing.
Thanks, Minister. The reason I was asking it, Convener, is because it is about how you supply these new heat networks and the critical role of local authorities in planning, leadership, as has been mentioned, but also accountability. So that's why I was keen, because it also gets income generation to local communities if it's done properly and low bills for people. So the feedback I've had from local authorities is they are under massive financial pressure to take this forward. So, again, that's back to your £300 million fund. It'd be very interesting to see how that's going to be spent. Thank you.
Thank you. If there's no other questions, then we'll move on to agenda item three, which is the formal consideration of the motion calling for the committee to recommend approval of the draft Heat Networks Supply Target Scotland Regulations 2023. I just remind everyone that only the Minister and members of the committee may speak in this debate, and I'd invite the Minister to speak to and move the motion.
Happy to move the motion.
Thank you. Are there any comments from the committee? I have a comment, but I'm happy to take any others first. Okay. Can I just say, Minister, I'm taken by the need of achieving a target and setting a target. I understand the need for that. The problem is the target that you set based on a current production of 1.18 terawatt hours now, and targets to go to 2.6 in 2027 and 2035 of 7 terawatt hours, whilst they may be aspirational, I have no idea whether they're achievable, and you haven't convinced me they are, and you haven't given me an indication of cost. So I am stuck, whereas I would like to agree a target. I don't see the current target has been correctly justified. Could you set my mind at rest, or have one more time at doing that, please, Minister?
As we discussed in the evidence session that we just held, the Scottish Government has consulted widely on a number of options for this target. It's not only a legal requirement that we set a 2035 target. I believe it is a very positive signal to the industry that we're serious about seeing the development of heat networks. We could have set a very stretching, much more aspirational target. What I think we've set is a more achievable target. It's still an aspiration to grow heat networks significantly in Scotland, but it's an achievable one. It's consistent with the advice that we've had from the UK Climate Change Committee, and it's consistent with a position that was supported, widely supported, in the consultation. Can I also just mention the business and regulatory assessment, impact assessment that's been provided, does suggest that the cost of meeting the target set in the SSI could be up to £6.2 billion, and it's likely that that cost will be shared, as I said earlier, between public support that's already been made available and private investment.
So £6.2 billion, of which at the moment you put up £300 million, is that right?
Of public funding, yes.
Yes, so the rest will come from the private sector.
From a range of sources.
Okay. I remain sceptical. Is there any other people with any questions? Sorry, Mark.
Just a comment, Convener. I mean, I think, you know, the approach the government's taken, perhaps are justified not putting a target for the 2035 into legislation originally, because it's clear a lot of work is needed to take place, particularly at local level, particularly with councils, to really understand in a granular way how this target can be met and indeed what the target should be. So, you know, I'm pleased that groundwork has been done. And I think what we have now is a target that's really going to drive that private investment, which is going to be so critical to meeting the gap and ensuring that we've got real projects on the ground that are well regulated, that do protect consumers, and that within that, hopefully there'll be opportunities for municipal ownership and public benefit as well. So good to see the stretching target brought forward, but good to see that it's going to be based on the reality of what is possible and what is going to be investable and bankable. Thanks.
Okay. Any other... Douglas.
Yeah, I'm actually more concerned now. I've heard the £6.2 billion figure, because I don't think we've, you know, Mark Roskell said a lot of the groundwork's been done. I don't think it has been done. I haven't seen anything here that says that we have got any idea how we'd get to that target. As much as I would like to get to that target, I have no idea how we'd get there. I don't know where the 6.2, well, only know where 300 million of it's going to come from. So I don't know where the other 5.9 billion is going to come from. So I'm really a bit concerned that we're setting a target here without knowing how on earth we're going to get there.
Okay. Minister, if there's no other comments, I don't invite you to sum up and respond to the debate you've heard.
Once again, I would say that we've consulted widely on a range of targets which are evidence-based. Widely supported in the consultation is the target that we're setting. It sets out for a strong growth within the heat network sector, which we believe not only sends the signal about what we intend to achieve and will build confidence amongst investors, but is an achievable target which will help to decarbonise Scotland. And I genuinely hope that as we develop policy and the wider heat and buildings approach, members across the chamber will recognise not only the opportunity but also the necessity of decarbonising Scotland's heat.
Okay, thank you. So we move then to the formal question. Is that motion S6M10778 in the name of Patrick Harvey be agreed? Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not all agreed. Okay, so we'll move to a division. There are three options, as I understand it. There's yes, no, and abstain. So I'm going to start off by asking those who vote in favour to raise their hands so I can clearly see, please. Sorry, just keep them there. It would be so much easier if we had electronic voting and we could do it, but we don't. Okay, those who are against the motion, please raise their hands. And those who wish to abstain, please raise their hands. So So the voting is 5 votes in favour of the motion. There are 2 abstentions, therefore the motion is agreed to. The committee will report on the outcome of this instrument in due course, and I invite the committee to delegate authority to me as convener to finalise the report for publication. Are we happy as a committee to do that? No one said no, so I'm going to take that as a yes. Thank you, committee, and thank you, Minister, and your officials for attending. I'm now briefly going to suspend the meeting before our next item. Welcome back. And this is gender item four on our agenda, which is an evidence session with Scotland's water industry regulators, Consumer Scotland and the Water Industry Commission for Scotland. Today's evidence session follows on from our meeting last week, when we heard from the Scottish Water on its latest annual report and accounts and the main challenges for the water industry in Scotland. We'll continue to explore those issues with today's panel, and I'm pleased to welcome Emma Ash from the Water Policy Manager from Consumer Scotland, Tracy Riley, the Head of Policy and Markets from Consumer Scotland, Fraser Stewart, the Research Manager for Consumer Scotland, and Alan Sutherland, the Chief Executive for Water Industry Commission for Scotland. Thank you for joining us today. I'm sorry we're a little bit behind in time-wise, but before I move on to the many questions that we've had, I think there's a brief opening statement, firstly from Emma and then from Alan. So, Emma, if you'd like to start away, please.
Thank you for having us to today's session for Scottish Water and giving me the opportunity for this opening statement. Consumer Scotland was set up by the Scottish Parliament under the Consumer Scotland Act 2020 as a non-ministerial office. As the statutory body for consumers in Scotland, our core purpose is to improve the lives of current and future consumers. Our strategic objectives, which are relevant to the water industry as well as other markets we work in, include enhancing understanding and awareness of consumer issues through our research and analysis, and using our findings to inspire and influence the public, private and third sectors to put consumer interests at the heart of what they do. We also want to enable the active participation of consumers in a fairer economy by improving access to information and support. Throughout, we take a partnership approach, collaborating closely with other organisations with interests and expertise in consumer issues. Our core funding comes from the Scottish Government's annual budget, but we also receive levy funding for our work relating to water. Our current levy funding for this year is £358,000. In our current work programme for the water sector, we focus on four key themes: climate change adaptation, equitable investment, fair markets and affordable services. As part of our statutory role, we work with the Scottish Government, sector regulators and Scottish Water to ensure that the needs and interests of consumers are represented in the design and delivery of Scottish Water's capital investment strategy. Our work includes producing research that promotes positive outcomes for consumers in key areas such as water and wastewater services to ensure they remain affordable and are resilient to climate change, and that they also meet the needs of current and future consumers. We are developing evidence to promote a non-domestic market that is fair and operates in a way that protects the interests of its customers as well as the wider good of the market. Recent Consumer Scotland research already shared with the committee includes a report on the importance of blue-green infrastructure in helping to reduce flooding caused by climate change, and a survey on consumer attitudes towards the transition to net zero. Once again, I'd like to thank you for inviting us to give evidence, and we look forward to your questions.
Thanks very much, Emma. Alan, I think you'd like to do a brief opening statement as well.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, everyone. Thanks for inviting me. It's always good to hear your questions. As you know, the Water Industry Commission is the economic regulator for the water industry in Scotland. Our statutory duty is to promote the interests of customers, both today's customers and future customers, which is important. At the end of 2020, we published our strategic review. This is a bit of context to hopefully help you in understanding what we're doing. That review is the mechanism by which we establish the lowest reasonable overall cost for Scottish Water to deliver the objectives of the Scottish Ministers within the principles of charging of the Scottish Ministers. So as we were going through that review, it became clear that Scottish Water would need to increase its maintenance and replacement expenditure by a factor of about three if it were to stop asset deterioration continuing, which is what we're currently seeing. Now, why is that important? Well, asset deterioration basically might not always be seen, in fact, probably rarely is until it's too late. But it does put a significant upward pressure on operating costs. It puts a significant upward pressure on carbon emissions. And it also makes it much, much more difficult to adapt to climate change. So at the end of a process of very substantial engagement with stakeholders and with input from OECD, we concluded that this investment could and should be phased, but that we needed to get there, to get to a more sustainable level by about 2040, which was a date that coincided with Scottish Water's net zero target. We also in that review saw improved operating and capital expenditure efficiency. But even with that, that still meant there had to be substantial increases in charges, which again we concluded should be phased. And that was before we knew inflation was going to be the sort of issue it is. Now, obviously, no one wants a higher bill, right? None of us want a higher bill. But we do want to be able to rely on a sustainable water, wastewater and drainage service. There were steps taken at the beginning of the period to protect vulnerable customers through the council tax reduction scheme. But more is going to be required, quite frankly. The committee heard evidence last week from Scottish Water that said because the board had opted for lower charge limits than we set in the determination, that they would have £500 million less to invest in this period. What they didn't go on to tell you is that if charges were to increase in line with inflation over this period, and at the moment they're increasing by about 4.5% less than inflation, then in future regulatory periods, from 2027 onwards, Scottish Water would have £200 million less every year to invest in the maintenance and replacement of its infrastructure. And that impacts levels of service, that impacts the ability to adapt to climate change. Now, why is this all important? Well, I think it's kind of obvious that we need to be in a position to have a proper response to climate change. But if we look at what is currently happening in England and Wales, investment levels in England and Wales have been 40% lower in the years since Scottish Water was formed in 2002 than they have been in Scotland. We are now seeing huge increases being put forward by companies in England and huge price increases following that. So just in the next 5 years, companies on average in England are asking for a 30% real increase in their tariffs. And the average of the companies that have produced sensible answers, right, so I'm taking away the higher outliers, are doubling their charges in real terms by 2040. So that compares with the 40% that we had in our strategic review. And what they are not doing is addressing the replacement and refurbishment of assets in the way that we are trying to do in Scotland. So our focus over the last 2 or 3 years has been to get much more clarity into what is being invested, why it's being invested, how it's being invested. This is much more challenging than it used to be because we've moved away from very discrete improvements to meet European standards. And we're focusing more and more on investments in replacing and refurbishing assets, which tend to be much smaller, much more discrete projects that are harder to see. Even more challenging than that is the sort of the green-blue solutions. And here there's two things. One, can we get the incentives right for people to pursue those green-blue solutions in the right way? Not always easy. And then monitoring that sufficient progress is actually happening in that, which is quite a challenge. So that's what we're looking for in terms of a prioritisation. There's been some progress in the last year, but it's not as fast as I would like, to be quite frank. We're now beginning the preparations for the next strategic review, which starts in 2027. What we will be looking for at that time is for Scottish Water to evidence in a way that is genuinely compelling to its customers and to Scotland more broadly what it needs to invest and why. We are expecting to publish a methodology for that review by February next year. So that's by way of context. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you very much, Alan. There are lots of questions Jackie, you're going to start us off today.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. Thank you very much for coming along. My first question, I'm just going to ask quite a broad question, and it's what is your broad assessment of Scottish Water's performance over the last year? If I can maybe start with Emma.
We work on a regular basis as our statutory role with stakeholders, including Scottish Water, and we attend various statutory meetings with them, and we engage with them on a regular basis to represent the consumer interest. We've found that process to be fairly collaborative. As a new organisation, they are keen to see the research that we develop and sort of let that help inform some of their decision making, which is very welcome.
Okay. But do you think that they're? Can you maybe go into some depth as to what you think have they performed well in the past year? Or
so, Scottish Water monitor their customer experience and their customer service level themselves, and there has been an improvement in that, which is good. And what we're seeing is that when we speak to consumers about the So there's a few opportunities that we've had this year through research to speak with consumers, is that they are generally quite happy with Scottish Water as a brand and as a product, the water that they receive. On particular issues, there's opportunity for perhaps more information when it comes to things like climate adaptation and what the opportunities are and what the scale of the problem is.
Okay, thank you. If I can come to Alan, can I have your views, please?
I think their performance over the last year has been broadly similar to that of the previous year. Their capital programme is running between 6 and 12 months behind on latest estimates and forecasts. Customer service levels, as measured by our overall performance assessment, are broadly flat year on year. It would be nicer to be seeing more demonstrable improvement in efficiency than we've seen. They do have a target to improve their underlying operating cost efficiency and their capital expenditure efficiency. I think the jury's out as to whether they're actually achieving that. It's unfair to look at it on the basis of 1 year. We have to look at it over a period, but I think the jury's out as to whether they're going to achieve that in this regulatory period.
So if I can just go in further with that, have you seen any evidence that Scottish Water is getting back on track? I know you said that there's still the six-month slippage, but mm-hmm. you know, moving ahead, are you confident that you're seeing some movement in getting back on track? I know you're not there; they're not there yet.
I think there has been an improvement over the last year, particularly over the last 6 or 8 months, in their level of engagement in terms of what they're delivering and how they're delivering it. But there's still some way to go.
Okay. And could you maybe expand a little bit on what the impact is to the project delays? In regards to the project delays, what's the impact on the quality of service that Scottish Water is providing?
Well, the Scottish Water runs an absolutely massive asset base, right? So about in price levels of 5 years ago, and let's face it, we've had capital inflation of 25 or 30% over that period, its asset base would have been valued at around £70 billion, right? So when you're talking about maybe £100 to £200 million worth of slippage in investment, you're not necessarily going to see it, but it is happening, and it is making things a little bit more challenging and a little bit more difficult than they otherwise would be, right? So should it be managed? You know, when you see the quality of the operational responses that Scottish Water generates to issues, they are very good at managing things. So we probably don't experience it. That doesn't mean that it's being done as well as it could be being done, and it's certainly not being done as cost-effectively. Responses is always much more expensive than proactive intervention to stop the issue happening first.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks. Jim, I think you were going to come in with some questions now, were you?
Yeah. Alan, you just said that stopping the problem happening before it happens is probably a better solution. And this takes me on to the area that the convener might try and stop me to talk about, which is a local constituency issue. But it is the point that I'm raising is was actually brought up in the minutes of your meeting on 21st of September 2022 about Glenfarg. Now, the Glenfarg project is clearly one that has been developed. There's a lot of money being spent on it. But they're putting three storage tanks in at the source for a system that is supposed to supply Glenrothes, which is 17 miles away. The piping to that system in Glenrothes has got various leakages in it that are known about. But they're putting their storage tanks in at the source rather than at the end. So my question was going to be to you that you have had issues, you've raised issues in the past about the completeness of the information that you provide and the information you get from Scottish Water to allow you to perform your regulated role. What are you not getting from it? And do you have any oversight over the operational side of that? Because what I can't understand is David Satty had made a comment in one of your previous meetings that there was £799 million worth of funding that had gone into Scottish Water which couldn't determine whether or not there had been any great improvements or not. And now I'm hearing a project where they're putting in several million pounds worth of investment, but putting the storage in at the source rather than at the place where it will be consumed. So if the leak or something happens in the 17-mile pipage system from the source to the consumer, what's the point of putting a storage system in when the storage system could quite easily be put in at the consumer end? It makes no sense whatsoever. Are you able to answer that at all?
I wish I could. I'm not an engineer, and I couldn't sensibly comment on the specific design of a particular project.
Okay.
What I would expect, though, is that there is a full proper appraisal that should be able to explain why they've done what they've done.
Okay. The convener was probably right to not allow me to ask that question, but I have it now on the record. So,
do you know, Jim, I've given up trying to stop you. You're just as tenacious as they come. Okay. Hold on, Jim. I'd just say you put the question on the record now, and I'm sure Scottish Water will be listening to this.
We will be having
a
conversation.
And I'm no doubt they will want to respond. If I could get you to move on to the next one, though, I'd appreciate it.
Absolutely. So the committee is aware that you guys have raised concerns, WICs have raised concerns about the quality and completeness of the information that Scottish Water provides. And I'm going to refer back again to the meeting of September 2022. Some of the things that were said in here, bear with me, Alan Sutherland, noted, it is difficult to understand the consequences of Scottish Water's decisions for future investment needs. And he asked Scottish Water, asked how Scottish Water would report any disconnect between maintenance and asset replacement in terms of the long-term position. Are you getting the kind of information that you now require? There are a whole range of other things within these minutes. I'm not going to take up the committee's time to go over, where quite clearly WICs have not been getting the information, or the information wasn't put to them in such a way that could allow them to make any sort of determination. Has that been improved?
It is starting to improve, but it has not improved anything like to the level that it needs to get to.
Okay. Thank you, Kevin.
Telling comment. Monica, you've got a question, then I'm going to ask some.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. I think Jackie Dunbar's initial questions touched on sort of general performance and general perception of the public in terms of Scottish Water. I just wanted to ask about the perception around sewage pollution, because that's an issue we raised with Scottish Water last week, and that is an area of concern to both communities and environmental groups. So keen to hear from the panel what impact these local concerns and media reports are having on consumer perceptions and, importantly, trust in Scottish Water. Maybe start with Consumer Scotland first.
Thank you for the question. We have, we're in the middle at the moment of quite a large piece of research with consumers taking place with them over a couple of months, looking at some of the big issues in terms of the water sector and how it adapts to climate change. And part of that is looking at CSOs, combined sewer overflows, and what consumers think about that. The conversations are quite broad. It's the same participants that come along to the research every week. So they're getting a real sort of sense of the issues at hand and then getting an opportunity to discuss those in more detail. And on CSOs, what we're getting a sense of at the moment, it is quite early, the research is still ongoing, but we're getting a sense of consumers, it is an issue that they are concerned about, but at the same time, they understand that they are a function of the drainage system. However, it can feel quite unpalatable as a concept, and they're really interested in discussing the solutions that exist. That's coming across quite strongly across the whole range of issues in terms of adaptation, is how people can be involved in the solutions as much as the investment that is going to be required in order to make sure they're not operating when they shouldn't be and that improvements are made where they can be, but there are other opportunities, and that's something that consumers are quite keen to sort of learn more about, not aware of a lot of those options, whether that might be just reducing blockages or thinking about blue-green infrastructure, which has been mentioned, and the opportunity that presents in terms of removing rainwater from the system.
I think it would be good to hear more about the research. I'm sure you wouldn't want to get into particular examples of particular communities, but some of the reports, some of the emails and letters that we get, people are very concerned about the impact on human health, the impact on nature and the environment. So what we've heard from Scottish Water is that they don't accept how things are being characterised in the media and by some consumers and community interests. So I just wonder, is there a gap in research? I don't know, Fraser, in your role, if you can maybe speak to that, but is there a gap in research? How could we address that? And if we do have this division where we have Scottish Water saying we don't recognise these concerns and people getting more and more vocal, how could we resolve that?
Thanks for the question. What we find, so we're a new organisation, we're building our evidence base as well, but we're very mindful of the messages that are coming back from some of the campaigning organisations and people on this committee who get constituency cases. We're very mindful of that it's a live issue that people feel quite strongly about, and quite rightly. We have started to explore this issue in amongst many. I mean, the piece of work that Emma just mentioned, it's a deliberative piece of research. It has quite a lot of breadth. It's around climate change adaptation as a whole. And part of that is going to be looking at CSOs, trying to understand how consumers feel about that as an issue for the country as a whole, but also how it impacts them in their communities and for them as individuals, concerns around public health, as you mentioned. We see this as probably the first stage in this building our evidence base. But what we're finding with the deliberative methodology is what really allows us to dig deep into exploring the issues. So we can kind of get away from the immediate responses. Because if you ask a survey question of people around sewage spillages on the local beach, you're going to get the immediate reaction to that. And of course, most of us are going to be horrified by the idea of that happening. But by looking at the issue in a bit more detail, by using some of these more qualitative approaches, it allows us to kind of dig a bit deeper. And the messages that are coming through from that piece of research so far, and obviously this is a word of caution, it's pre-analysis, we don't have the final report yet, is that people are... they see it as something that they want to have a say in terms of what the solutions might look like But what they are looking for is also leadership from the company and from Scottish Government. So we just don't accept it as a factor of the system. There must be ways of dealing with it in the future so that we can, you know, live in nicer places.
Well, that's a really important piece of work, so thank you for explaining that, Fraser. Before I come to Alan to get his perspective, will that research look at not just those overflow events, but the dry spill incidents as well?
So the piece of research is probably at a higher level than looking at the very specifics around wet and dry spills. But I think where we're kind of moving towards is thinking that we are probably going to have to do a bespoke piece of work in the future that will look specifically at that issue, because it is coming up as important when we're talking to consumers and also campaigning organisations, and you know, the media coverage is quite extensive.
Okay, that's really informative. Thank you. Alan, your perspective on that?
Well, I think probably like all of you, when you read or hear people's experience, you go, it's pretty horrible, right? I think there are, I do have some sympathy for Scottish Water, because some of the characterisations that you will read in the media that raw sewage or something was pumped into a river, well, wasn't pumped, and it's not raw sewage, it's very heavily diluted. Now, it's not to excuse it, I'm just saying that that's, you know, the media characterisation and the actuality are a bit different one to another. And, you know, the more, you know, we get our information from the media, right, so we respond to the, you know, the presented answer rather than the actual answer. I think there are things that we as societally have to think very hard about, and there are potential roles for the Parliament. So, for example, the fact that we allow gardens to be paved over so people can park their cars in their gardens, right, increases the amount of hard standing and therefore increases the amount of rainwater that doesn't drain away naturally but finds its way into the sewers, right? When the sewer systems were designed, that we didn't do that. Right, so that's a new problem, and you've got to deal with it. I talked in my introductory remarks about the levels of maintenance that we've been engaging in, and we've been seeking to minimise costs and minimise bills, and good reasons for doing that. But that means that we've not been maintaining sewer systems with quite the diligence that they might have done. So, you know, the odd brick or two out of place, just like a brick in your cistern, means you use less water, right? So there's less room for the water to go through, so it's more likely to spill than it would have been if the sewer was in absolutely perfect nick. And when we look at solving this, I think we've got to ask ourselves a really serious question. And here I would differ from what DEFRA in England is saying. DEFRA in England appears to be suggesting that one can build one's way out of this. I don't accept that. There is, you know, if you look at the Thames Tideway Tunnel that was encouraged by European legislation to be built in year 2000, it's going to be finished relatively shortly. Latest forecast is going to be full a year or 2 years after it was built, right? So why didn't we build it a bit bigger? We didn't know, right? So when you look forward and you look at potential rainfall patterns in 30, 40, 50 years' time, you see that there's no realistic way that you're going to build an infrastructure that could cope that amount of water coming that quickly. So we're going to have to do it very, very differently. And that's where sort of your green blue, your sponge city, your reopening of culverted watercourses to become natural streams, stroke rivers in cities is going to be critically important. Because if we don't do that, we're just not going to manage the levels of surface water that we will see in 30 or 40 years. So at one level, we should be looking at this as a really important learning experience for ourselves, right? We've got to do things differently. And if we don't, then we're going to have a big problem on our hands, because it would get an awful lot worse if we try and stick our heads in the sand and pretend we just got to fix a few CSOs. That's not the issue.
Thank you, Alan, for very eloquently taking through some of the big challenges and the possible solutions. I won't draw into that too much because I know we don't have time, but just to bring it back to Scottish Water then, notwithstanding some of the wider challenges that are not all within the control of Scottish Water, if we have potentially a growing problem around CSOs, people concerned about human waste ending up in our watercourses, impact on public health and environment, Scottish Water are saying that they're not getting their lawyers onto the media. I did ask them that last week. Are these stories so wildly exaggerated that you're going to get your lawyers involved? They're not doing that. But what advice would you give to Scottish Water? Because we don't want to have a breakdown in public trust and confidence. As good as it is to have all this research, I'm sure the team at Consumer Scotland have probably got other things that they'd rather be researching. So what advice would you give to Scottish Water to try and speak to communities, do that piece of education work, but ultimately do better because we need better outcomes?
I think Scottish Water does a lot of valuable work, including in paid media and TV, trying to tell us about not flushing wipes and all the rest of it, right? So that's good. I think my the reason I gave you that sort of future look on investment as to what happens in the future because of charge decisions now is because I think that's one of the things I'd like to see Scottish Water do an awful lot better. Because I think if you're going to have a proper discussion with your customers, you've got to explain what the long-term effects are, the medium and long-term effects. Because my experience when you do sit down with a community is that they really want to talk about these things over the medium and long term. They accept that things will go wrong in the short term. Might not like it, but what they want to know is how we're going to get out of it. So I think the more that we can future look, the more that we can explain why sort of just building something new isn't going to solve things and why we have to think differently. Right. It's quite amazing when you look at sort of differences in intensity of rainfall that you're going to get in 40 or 50 years' time. It's actually quite difficult to believe at first. And then you look back at history and you see what's happened in the last 5 or 10 years and you say, oh, all right then. Yeah, no, I get it. Right. But you've got to be exposed to that in order to do it. And that's where I think Scottish Water could do more.
Very helpful. Thank you.
Okay. One of the points you made earlier, I think, is Pete Jim's, a further question from Jim, so I'll come to him.
Thank you very much, convener. And Al, this has come back to you again. You talked there about, replacing a brick in a sewer and potentially maybe not doing as much of that. We've all received a briefing from Unison talking about Scottish Water privatisation by stealth and union busting. And they're making the claim that Scottish Water is, I think the phrase is, Scottish Water is being hollowed out. So if you talk about the relationship between Scottish Water and consumers, Scottish Water and its workforce, there are clearly issues there that are going to have to be addressed. And I'm not going to get into specifics of it, but the reason I'm raising that is I wanted to come back to the point that I was asking you earlier on. When you're getting information from Scottish Water, do you have sufficient powers to compel them to come to give you the necessary information that you require so that we can avoid these kinds of situations happening in the first place?
We've got plenty of powers to ask for the information and to require its receipt. What quality it is something that, unfortunately, we don't have any particular powers over. So other than asking again, which is what we do.
So that sounds to me like what you get is obfuscation for questions that you're asking for legitimate answers to.
I'm not sure. I think obfuscation is a rather strong word. I'd say it's just not as good as it should be. Okay. Right? And I think there's, let me give you a concrete example. Right, we ask for a very, very comprehensive annual return every year. Right. It's based on something that Ofwat adapted from Treasury back in the 1980s, right? So it's been going for yonks. And if you go back about 10 years, we would have been in a situation where we would have had 6, 7, 8 sort of number of queries on the information that we got from Scottish Water, right? Last year, we had well over 100, right? Now, that is essentially just people who are either new in role or less experienced or less diligent than their predecessors. I don't know which one it is, right? But the fact is, same return, many more queries today than it was before. So that just gives you a clear indication as to why we are frustrated.
Okay. Thank you, Convener.
Okay. Thank you very much. Alan, these questions from me are to you. You raise your money, I think it's in 2021-2022, £4.5 million from levy. Is that right?
Yeah, about that.
Yeah. £3 million of it goes in staff costs. In 2021-22, 2.9 something, but let's say 3 million, which allowed you to have a surplus of 600,000 in that year to offset the £600,000 loss the previous year. Mm-hmm. Seems quite big fluctuations between profit and loss. And is the levy right, or are you getting too much money in?
That's a good question, isn't it? I'm sure there are others who have a worse revenue income level than we have, but in the period 21 to 27, our income from Scottish Water goes up 1% a year. That's 1% nominal, not 1% real. And our revenue from licensed providers goes up 3% nominal per year. One of the things that we have started doing increasingly actively is to support the Scottish Government's hydro nation initiative. And that has meant that we have done very substantial projects in Romania and in New Zealand and have brought in a very substantial amount of money. So the reason that we've got a surplus is because I think last year we had something over 1.1 million that came in from the New Zealand government for our time and services and advice.
So it just seems quite a large amount of money and in quite a small budget. And with 26 employees on average, a £3 million wage packet is over on average, and of course no one's average, some will get paid more than others, Alan. On average it's £100,000 per employee before you add on the pension. So is that about right?
The salary cost that you've got in the accounts is the base salary of people, the pension and the employer on costs, so all of those go into that salary number. But the basic math is correct, yes. If you were to take the fully loaded cost of an employee, take the total salary cost and divide by the number of employees.
But what we're saying basically is the top end of the salary is 185,000 in that year. It just seems quite big salaries for 26 people. One has to ask the question, as it's raised from levy and there's a surplus in the year, whether we've got those figures right. Are you convinced we have?
All I can tell you, Convener, is that it would be impossible for me to go out and recruit the analytical talent that I need in the market. I have to develop and train my own analytical talent. So of the three directors who work for me, who are analytical in their bent, each of them started their career with me at some point in the last 24 years. One has been with me consistently for 11 or 12 years. The other two were with me for a period, left to get more experience somewhere else, but came back. Both of the ones who came back earn less now than they would have done had they not come back. So they're coming back for reasons of public service. So, yes, I'm not suggesting that we're not well paid. We are well paid, Convener, there's no question about that. But we are paid less than the market rate for the job, if that matters.
I think my concern is I want to know that the taxpayers are getting value for money. And having looked last week with bonuses at a salary that could top 430,000 seemed a huge amount of money, and it would be improper of me not to ask the questions which you have to.
Just to be clear for the committee, there are no bonuses.
I see that.
And in my case, there is no pension contribution because I'm not eligible for one.
I saw that as well. I read the accounts with interest. Douglas, you have some questions.
As did I, Convener. I'm going to go back to customer charging now, and it's a question for Alan, first of all. I was going to ask, do you think Scottish Water is striking the right balance in delivering on its investment commitments and keeping bills low for customers? But you've touched on that in your opening remarks. So do you think the charges should be increased more to the level that they could actually go to?
I think it is incredibly difficult when you've got inflation running in double digits to try and get more money from a number of many income levels within society. So to go to the convener's point, should I pay more? Yeah, right. I can afford to pay more. So, but that's I'm not typical, right? Probably none of us in this room are that typical in that sense. So I think the real question for us is how are we going to protect those who genuinely can't pay? Now, in Scotland, we are better at that than elsewhere in GB because we charge a lot of council tax, and at least that's got A, some forms of relief available, and B, asks people who are in wealthier houses to pay a bit more. But I'm not sure that's enough, to be quite honest with you. I think if we are going to have the sorts of revenue adjustment for the industry that are required, then more is going to probably need to be being done. But that essentially is a political decision. It's not, I can advise and I do, try and explain that, just raising revenues and increasing levels of indebtedness is not actually a way forward. It's only a sustainable increase if people can actually pay it. Mm.
But do you think the overall pot, maybe how we slice it might be different, should go actually back up to the CPI plus 2%? Because as you suggested earlier, if we don't go back to that level, we're just going to store up problems for future generations, aren't we?
Well, I think you've got to look at it in the context of what inflation is and in what wage growth and that sort of thing is. And I think you've got to look at how much are you trying to raise and what else could you do to protect those who can't pay. And I think there are things that could be being done. So I think there's a sort of in the round solution that might be possible. Hopefully inflation starts to come down. I'm not as optimistic as I'd like to be on that front. But hopefully inflation comes down more quickly than some suggest. But there's going to be a challenge. Right? Mm. If you can't increase total revenues by, in our case, 40 to 50%, in the case of south of the border, 100%, and not have people, some people struggle to pay. So the question is, how are you going to balance that? Mm. How are you going to make it possible?
And so you said you might have some suggestions to government. What would your suggestions be then to government, how they could raise that money, but maybe not impacting those
So to give you one example, one of the things that I have in the past suggested is that the rate of council tax relief, right, at the moment it's 35%, for someone on 100% council tax benefit, I've suggested that 35% could be increased very marginally every year. And that would mean that you could have a nominal, right, not real, nominal freeze in that household's bill year on year. Right? So that would mean you would go from, say, 35 to something like 36.8 or something. I know it's a very spuriously accurate number, excuse me, I kind of do spuriously accurate numbers, but you go from 35 to 36.8, you go to 38.5 or something, and that would mean that for people who are on 100% council tax benefit, so those who test as being the most vulnerable, would not see any increase. Now that to me would be quite a good thing to do. The cost of doing that is relatively trivial to the rest of us. is a rounding error to the rest of us. So that, to me, would be something that we could do and we could look at. But, again, it's a political decision.
Yeah. But do you think it's right for customers to be paying more when you've mentioned earlier about there's still problems with efficiencies at Scottish Water, there's still issues with the quality of information you're getting. There still seems to be issues about how they're spending their money. There's issues about spending money on bonuses, for example. Do you think it's right to be asking customers to pay more when there's still those underlying issues with Scottish Water?
So I think there's two things that we've got to try and keep separate, right? So the first is that we have a need to invest for the medium and longer term. And the reason that I'm suggesting people pay more is to be able to address those investment needs that we have going forward. I agree with you that there are steps that could and should be being taken in operating costs, and that those should be trending down in real terms, and at the moment they're not. So I would like to see that. But to be absolutely clear, when we set our price caps, we are assuming that that efficiency happens, right? And if it doesn't happen, then we'll be asking questions when we've got to the point of analytical confidence that it's not happening. We'll be wondering, exploring why it hasn't happened and what's going to be done about it.
So do you think it's right paying those bonuses when the efficiencies aren't being met?
It's not for me to comment on the level of bonuses.
Maybe just turn to Consumer Scotland now. In terms of customers being asked to pay more, maybe you haven't done any research on this yet, but is there an appetite for customers to pay more if more is going to be spent on the service, and whether that means better quality or more value for money?
I suppose there's two pieces of research that we've got actually that might sort of help there. We've got our overall piece, which we're looking at in terms of speaking to consumers about how we adapt to climate change and the investment. So we'll have a sense of what consumers think once we've kind of got more findings from that in terms of the cost that might have on them. But we've also done some internal analysis as a piece of research looking at affordability for consumers in terms of the bills. So just sort of coming back at thinking about the water charge reduction scheme and those sorts of schemes that are available. Our research on that isn't published yet, but we'll share it when we do. But at the moment, there are sort of the team that have developed that piece of research are engaging with stakeholders. And it's showing as an analysis that water poverty has fallen in the last couple of years, likely as a result of the lower than inflationary increases in bills, the water charge reduction scheme that went from 25 to 35%. But we're probably going to likely to see that sort of unwind as if bills are to go up. And I think that's where we're looking to sort of develop some policy around. We've got this modelling and looking at the different impact of bill increases and where policy can be, where we can make policy recommendations in terms of how you can support certain consumer groups, particularly those low-income ones. So as we develop that, we'll certainly share it with the committee. But we're aware that any increase will have an impact. And I think we do need to think about the pace of bills and also the communication, I think, to consumers is really important as to how it's being spent and why we need to do it.
But from, I think, what I gather, you haven't really completed any of that research work on, so people understand, yes, they're paying more, but it's needed for the future. That's not been done yet, has it?
Our research, sorry.
Yes.
So it's an ongoing, it's a two-month workshop with consumers, so we're still in the middle of those workshops, yeah.
Okay. Last question I had is, should the Scottish Government be doing more to help ease the pressure on, increases in water charges, or is that?
There is, some of these decisions around water charge reduction scheme, that is something that the government will have to think about. But there are other things we're conscious that when people who are eligible for that scheme, they can sometimes often fall into debt because they don't know they're liable to pay it. So we did. We did ask the government a couple of months ago to consider asking local authorities to do a bit more in terms of supporting consumers who fall into debt because they've not paid their water charge. So that 35% reduction, they still obviously have to pay some of their water charges, but they're usually, obviously, they're exempt from council tax, so that sometimes that can cause confusion and they don't pay. So we see consumers falling into debt there, and we're looking for local authorities to... We've asked the government to ask local authorities to consider carrying out ability to pay assessments when somebody falls into debt there, to try and sort of stop the issue becoming bigger than it already is for those particular households.
Okay. Thanks, Camino.
Thank you, Douglas. I think the next question is coming from Mark.
Yeah, if I could just ask a question actually on the back of that last question. I'm interested to get a sense of whether... You know, the consumer research shows whether those consumers who can afford to pay may be prepared to pay more if it's linked to tangible environmental improvements. So, you know, I suppose the question crudely might be, you know, would you be prepared to pay an extra 30p if you're to get that improvement in that river or cleaner beach or whatever? Is there a sense of that kind of thinking coming through? Is that...
I think it might be a bit early. I don't know if you've got any comments, Fraser.
Excuse me. It's very difficult for us to be able to say it in that way with that particular piece of deliberative research that we're doing, because it's not... The piece of work isn't around, you know, how much extra are you willing to pay to see, you know projects around trying to adapt to climate change or reduce emissions. However, there is previous work that the previous customer forum did around prices. Now, this, I'm going to say, is pre-pandemic and pre-cost of living crisis. But that piece of work showed that consumers were willing to absorb a small increase in price for doing things around improving infrastructure for climate change purposes. But it's probably somewhat out of date now, so there's probably an argument for revisiting that as an issue, given that we're in a different... Things have moved on slightly. There's been, you know, a few large crises that, as a country, we've had to face. But where we do touch on kind of... it's not a willingness to pay piece that we're doing at the moment, so it's difficult to say exactly where, you know, what the risk appetite is for people. It's certainly worth us exploring further. But what we do get a sense is that people recognise there's a problem with the system and where we're wanting to get to as a country. But we haven't got as far at the moment in trying to put a figure onto that from our consumer research.
I mean, it'd certainly be interesting to see what that kind of research throws up, because you said things have moved on, not just with the pandemic, but also there's a different narrative now around, you know, how we use, you know, our water resources and the kind of the impact on that in terms of sewage and everything else. Can I turn to yourself then, Alan, around, you know, the role of the WICs and whether your regulatory approach... is having to evolve given the challenges of climate change. And I suppose I'm mindful of the fact that, you know, we've seen this with Audit Scotland starting to sort of push its public audit approach now much more into counting carbon, much more into looking at how public sector is delivering those long-term changes that are needed. What does that look like for WICs, because you were set up with very specific remit under the Act 2005. You know, you're an economic regulator predominantly, but we're in quite a different world now to where we were in 2005. So how are you adjusting your regulatory approach to meet the challenge that we now face?
Okay. Thanks. That's a great question. I think, yes, we're having to do things differently. We want to do things differently. There's a sort of hidden nuance in your question, which kind of suggests that us economists are only interested in pounds, shillings and pence. I don't think that's actually quite right, certainly not in my case or the people that I work with's case. So we are very interested in... externality costs, whether those be carbon, social benefits, or others. So to give you a couple of examples of how things are different, one of the ways in which we have already taken this step, in the last price review, we ring-fenced an amount of money which said, all right, sometimes there are going to be investment solutions which would be cheaper in cash terms if you do them the environmentally friendly way. Right? Sometimes those solutions might be more expensive in cash terms. But if the carbon or other societal benefits outweigh that difference in cash, we will give you extra cash to do the more expensive solution that is more environmentally friendly. Right? So that has been an open offer that's been out there for Scottish Water to take advantage of. They haven't taken advantage of it yet, but that promise was there that they could have the money. We would give them the money if they did that took those steps. If I switch attention to things like green, blue, natural solutions, one of the things that we're trying to encourage is to take an appropriate timescale in considering the costs and benefits of solutions. Now, if you take standard engineering sort of appraisal, you might look at something over a 20 or a 25 year time horizon, right? What that doesn't show you are the upgrades in concrete and future rebuilds that will be required beyond the time horizon of your analysis, right? If I switch to opening culverts and having a natural river flow, right? Once I've done it, right? I might have to cut the grass occasionally around it, but I don't have to do anything else. So if you use sort of a 50 or a 60 year time horizon, that solution is going to become cheaper than the standard grey solution quite often, right? So just the way in which you go about analysing the project is going to have to be different, right? And that's why these sort of long-term strategic thinking is as important as it is. And that's what we're trying to do, right? We're trying to give them as much flexibility as possible, but I think what's happened is that they've taken the flexibility but been rather less good about the accountability of what are they actually doing specifically. And that's what we've got to try and rein back and get a degree of proper control over.
No, thanks for that. As a good, clear example of the challenges, and I recognise your own work in ensuring that externalities are internalised over a number of years. So please don't read anything else into what I'm saying here. But I suppose I will ask a question then, just around the role of WICs. And I think we're heading towards new legislation coming forward. On water and sewage specifically, but do you see the role and the way that WICs are set up as fit for purpose for where we are now? Is there a need to perhaps look again at the role of WICs and the duties that you have, or are you unable to comment on that, or you don't feel that there is anything worth commenting on?
I'll give you my perspective is actually that the Parliament was pretty clever in terms of what it asked us to do. Much as I would like to think that I value sustainable development and a climate-friendly Scotland as important things, I don't really think it's for the Water Industry Commission to set policy. In fact, I know it's not for us to set policy. So I think that the thing that's going to be increasingly important is that the objectives that come to us to be costed need to think in that sort of broader space. And I think Scottish Government has been moving in that general direction, but there's probably more that could be done. I think the consideration of thinking about charging separately for drainage and sewerage and that sort of thing, that's probably a really sensible thing to be doing, because it will create incentives to harvest rainwater, to manage the surface area, put down porous surfaces rather than hard surfaces, all of those good things, right? But people only do it if there's a, I think the convener said earlier, is there going to be a return on my money, right?
Okay, thanks. I'll come back in later.
Interesting concept. I mean, it would require a massive amount of work on most properties and buildings to separate, in many cases, wastewater from dirty water.
In some cases, it depends what you're talking about, convener, right? So if you're talking about the internal plumbing, right, yes, right, very difficult. If you're talking, say, roof water, and where that roof water goes from the drains and, comes through your guttering and down, right, that probably could be done much more easily than something internal. So there are things that could be being done, and every little bit helps here.
I agree. I'm just thinking about all the buildings I see around Edinburgh where their gutters disappear under the ground, and I'm not sure anyone probably knows where they're connected into.
Well, I think that goes into the same category as the gardens that are all paved over in central Edinburgh as well, to the same effect.
Okay, thank you. Are there any more questions on this section before we move on to the next bit? Sarah, Monica, I was wondering if you had a question you were thinking, but on project delivery. Are you happy that's been answered on this section?
It was just a sort of broad question I had about net zero delivery. It was around whether Scottish Water's assessment that remains on track to deliver its net zero commitments, whether the panel agrees with that assessment. So
are you happy it's been answered, or would you like to Alan to have a...
Maybe a yes or no answer would be the ultimate answer, but if there's nothing to be added, the jury's out, perhaps.
On a net zero progress, there's always more that can be being done.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess the day that, as a regulator, you're going to be satisfied that enough's being done is probably the day that you're not a regulator anymore.
Okay. And Sarah, did you want to come in on anything on that?
It was only to comment that last week I'd asked about the income generation Scottish Water did in terms of using their infrastructure for renewables.
Yeah.
And it's kind of interesting to see to what extent that gives them additional income that can keep household bills down. A very short issue, but quite complex.
This is quite a complicated issue, but... the way in which household bills would ultimately be kept down is if Scottish Water is earning a return above its cost of capital on non-core activities it engages in, because its only source of funding, seed capital, if you like, for those are the profits that it makes within its core business. All the profits already made, and that's money that gets reinvested. So, we as customers are contributing to all of those. Hopefully, they're all going to earn returns, and they will bring bills down. But it's not just about bringing bills down. It's about what contribution are they making to. The net zero challenge that Scottish Water has ahead of it. That bit's got to get monetised as well, or at least considered. If you don't want to monetise it, you've got to consider it in the same breath as the costs.
Thanks.
Thank you very much. And that really sort of brings an end to this session. Although we're going to keep some of the witnesses on, I think, Alan and Emma, you are going to slip away. So I'm going to briefly suspend the meeting to allow you to slip away. And I'd say to committee members, could we be back here at 25 past, please? Hey, and thank you. Welcome back. This is our next item of business, agenda item 5, which is an evidence session with Consumer Scotland, part of our stage 1 scrutiny of the Circular Economy Bill. I'm pleased to welcome back Tracy Riley, Head of Policy and Markets for Consumer Scotland, and Fraser Stewart, Research Manager. Thank you very much for providing a written submission to the committee. And I'm going to start off with a couple of questions on that, if I may. Let's see if I've got them right. What you said in your evidence is that the consumers were very much brought into the fact of the requirement for circular measures within the bill. But there was some confusion or dubiety between consumption and sustainability. And I want to know if you feel whether the bill deals with these two things, which may butt up against each other a bit. Tracy, do you want to start off on that?
I think it's important to say that we welcome the bill. The bill will support consumers and businesses to reduce consumption and to use resources more efficiently. In broad terms, we know that consumers are concerned about climate change. We know that they want to do more. We know that sometimes they don't know what the thing they need to do is. We are concerned that we want to see the bill and the strategy which will be developed under the bill focusing on those actions which have the highest impact on sustainability. I wonder if Fraser might want to speak a little bit about our recent research in a moment, but certainly we found that 2/3 of consumers didn't know or weren't sure what they needed to do to help Scotland reach its net zero targets, and that is an issue of concern to us. So we think that on the back of that research, there remains significant scope to help build consumer understanding on what they might do and what actions they might need to take, and to look at the specific role that consumers have in helping us meet our climate targets. We just really want to ensure that consumers are at the heart of that transition and that the impacts on both small businesses and consumers are considered when assessing net zero and climate-related policies.
So Fraser, just before I bring you in, just say on that, I mean, framework bills and actually seeing what's behind that, are you saying that it's as important to see what's behind it as what it enables?
I think it is. The bill is very much a framework measure, so it sets a broad suite of measures that government may then bring forward further measures to implement those things, whether by regulation or by strategies. I think a strategy is a desirable thing. I know that in preparing for the bill, Zero Waste Scotland undertook international research on comparisons, and it showed that having statutory measures rather than voluntary measures did help prioritise the key measures to adopt, provided a framework for interrelated policies. There are a lot of policies that need to work together in this space, and a strategy is one way of ensuring that they do so, whether that be the National Performance Framework, the Climate Change Plan, the sector plans that underlie that, packaging regulations or price marking orders, all of those things need to operate in alignment for consumers to get the best out of this. So although it is a framework bill, we think that the things that come under that, as you allude to, will be just as important as the bill itself.
Fraser, do you want to come in briefly on that?
Yeah, thank you. So as Tracy says, what our research, and we've shared the report with the committee, the survey work that we've just recently completed, what it's showing is that consumers are concerned about climate change. They see it as one of the big challenges for us as a society and a country. But what's coming through from that work is that there's a lot of confusion as well. They don't know what it is that they need to be doing to be able to make a contribution to achieving the targets. What makes that more complex is that it depends on the market that you're kind of talking about. It depends on the level of kind of interest and the level of engagement around what people are being asked to do. And certainly what our evidence is showing is at the moment is that there can be a lack of information. And we'll hear often from local authorities say, well, we provide you know, information on how to take part in recycling or reuse schemes, but actually when we then speak to our consumers, that's not always the message that's coming back from them. So there is probably a need for simplifying things, making sure that the core message is getting across. And I think we would see the bill as an opportunity for getting some of that stuff done.
Okay, so one of the things that you suggested was that targets are going to be a way of helping people buy into this, inspiring them to be part of the solution. So could you give me some areas where you think targets would be particularly helpful in a bill that appears to be quite frameworky?
I know you had quite a detailed session with, for example, Zero Waste Scotland last week. Recycling is one of those areas in which I think quite a lot of progress has been made, but that progress is now beginning to plateau, which is one of the reasons we think that legislation is necessary rather than just leaving it to a voluntary approach. So I think some targets in that area will continue to need to be met, particularly on the percentages, say, of waste going to various ways of disposing of it, whether it be, as we talked about earlier, incineration or landfill or recycling. One way in which the bill can help drive sustainable changes is to help increase the degree to which we're focusing not just on recycling but on moving things further up the waste hierarchy, so that we are talking about reusing things, repairing things, and about extracting the value from those resources more effectively and keeping them in use longer. So I think targets around those types of measures are quite strictly related to the waste hierarchy. I can't say that phrase today clearly. Would be of definite benefit.
And Fraser, are there any areas where you think targets might on top of those, or are you happy with those as the...
I think targets are useful in terms of getting over the message that we're trying to head somewhere. But I think we need to also be realistic, though, when it comes to people making decisions at home on a day-to-day basis. A government target probably isn't what's at the front of people's minds. It's probably, I've got all this stuff and I don't actually know what to do with it. And so getting clearer messaging is useful, but there also needs to be the correct infrastructure. There also needs to be the facility to actually be able to do it in a way that is simple to do and fits in with the kind of the rhythm of people's everyday lives when we have lots of competing things to be achieving on a day-to-day basis.
So just, and then I'm going to move on to Monica. So what you're saying is if there's a target which is easy to achieve because it becomes second nature, that's the target we should be aiming for rather than something aspirational that says we're going to have 100% of recycle or waste recycled. Is that what you're saying?
Correct me if I'm being too broad in what I'm saying here. But I think the two barriers that really come strongly through our research when we ask consumers why they are not making more sustainable choices are convenience and cost. So it needs to be something that is, there need to be affordable alternatives to things which are not sustainable at the moment. And there's, as Fraser says, there need to be things that people can fit into their everyday lives, which is why I think we've probably made reasonable progress on recycling, because it's something that doesn't require as much effort, say, as seeking out a repair shop and physically taking something to a repair shop, whether that be a small electrical item or a piece of clothing. There are some great initiatives out there, places like the Edinburgh Remakery, the Tool Library, lot of things in the Deputy Convener's constituency. But we'd like those things to be second nature, not just to people living in that area, but across the rest of the country, in terms of being, rather than just buying new things constantly. You know, maybe you could approach a consumption decision differently by looking at whether the thing that you will buy will actually last longer or could be repaired, rather than just buying the newest, shiniest version of that thing every time the newest, shiniest version is available. There are all sorts of ways in which we need consumers to be able to change those kind of consumption patterns.
And in fairness to other members of the committee, I must say there are other great places outside Ben's constituency area that do recycling. Monica?
I don't want to get in the middle of that debate. But thank you for your written submission, your written evidence, and on powers for single-use charges, your written submission emphasises the need to consider impacts on people on lower incomes and vulnerable people in relation to single-use charges. So my question is, how should single-use charges be introduced and how should they be balanced with other measures or supports to ensure that they are fair?
As I alluded to earlier, single-use chargers are probably most effective where there are accessible and affordable and sustainable alternatives available to the product that you are charging for or looking at banning. So, for example, we saw with plastic carrier bags, there were alternatives that were available and that were relatively affordable. Whether or not consumers in vulnerable circumstances, such as low-income households, will be disproportionately impacted by chargers like that will depend on how that system is designed, and we know that that again will come through secondary legislation. Certainly the Fairer Scotland duty assessment suggests that measures might be needed to support households to purchase longer lasting goods. While those are cost effective in the long term, those could be initially unaffordable unless there is targeted support. So in the case of more expensive items, it is possible that more targeted financial support might be needed to be provided there. Again, as you allude to, chargers are only part of the solution. We need to look at how we can improve consumer awareness about the impacts of choosing single-use items. And we also need to work with manufacturers to develop more sustainable products, look at using alternative materials, and at exploiting the technological advances that are now available. So there is a range of measures, at one end working with manufacturers, and at the other end working with consumers. It has to... That type of action will need to be done at both ends of that spectrum.
Thank you. And when you say targeted support, do you mean, for example, grants that would be funded by central or local government, or do you mean something else?
It could be, or it could be about working with existing community organisations to supply alternative products to people that they are working with. And that's maybe particularly important if you're looking at things in hygiene settings with groups that have health needs, or in food-related settings. So we know that it's often easier to get those type of initiatives to be successful if you're working in environments where people are already going. So if you're working with community groups where people are already visiting them, whether that be food banks or other support sources out there, then it's just easier to get things done and to make those products accessible to consumers, to provide them if you're looking at where people are already going, whether that be libraries, community centres, or any other community-based organisations.
Okay, and in order to achieve a just transition for consumers, are there any other changes to the bill that you would like to see or could suggest?
I think, as the convener says, it is very much a framework bill. So at this stage, it's difficult to identify any issues of that nature. Where we would be more likely to be able to identify them is where, for example, the strategy is brought forward for consultation, and we can look at inputting then, or where there are regulations on single-use charging. We are in touch with the government team that are working on single-use charging, and would be very happy to work with them.
View on that frameworky approach, I think, as the convener called it, is there a disadvantage in that approach, or are you happy that the strategy will pick up a lot of the operational stuff?
It's always balance. I think if you put too much in primary legislation, then it can have the effect of fossilising that, meaning that you only need to go back and introduce more primary legislation to amend what you've just brought in. And I think at a time when there are a lot of technological advances, it probably makes sense to leave some flexibility to the implementation. The challenge that then arises, as you heard from the Hospitality and Food and Drink panel, is that businesses, including small businesses, do want clarity and do want consistency and need to be clear, need to have a long enough time frame to be able to adapt to those changes coming in. Ultimately, I think that's probably a question for this committee as to whether that balance is right. But
it's always a discussion for this committee. Just want to pick up on disposal of unsold goods. I wonder if you can maybe talk us through what are the possible risks and opportunities for consumers and business of introducing restrictions on disposal of unsold goods, and have you looked at other examples, for example, of food or other goods redistribution schemes from any other countries to better understand some of the impacts?
I've not had a chance to do that research yet. As others mentioned earlier, we are only in our second full year of operation. That's something we may consider doing in future years, as looking at more international comparisons of what has and has not worked. I note that there was some discussion at previous panel regarding the definition of consumer goods and the width of that. It is fair to say it is a very broad definition. different considerations might apply to different types of goods. For example, textiles or electronics, which are longer life, will have different considerations to, for example, food or beauty products, which might have shorter shelf lives. So it's important that businesses and retailers are able to understand what exactly will be caught by the definition of consumer goods. On the plus side, I would say that these measures can probably help reduce overproduction and encourage more sustainable stock control measures once they're in place and businesses have had a chance to adapt to those. If it's delivered effectively, it should be able to help reduce actual raw material usage and ensure that we get maximum usage of the materials where those have been brought into life. And it might also, I think, as other panels alluded to, allow for development of new economic opportunities to connect up different parts of the supply chain in terms of distributing those goods that will now no longer be able to be destroyed for onward use. One of the risks that we would like to see addressed is the risk that goods that are subject to recall or that are unsafe or counterfeit might be at risk of entering the supply chain again, and that the provisions will simply need to be constructed in a way that ensures that doesn't happen. We would recommend, for example, that trading standards bodies be brought into those discussions because they have considerable expertise, along with OPSS, who work on product recalls. Those would be my headlines, thoughts on that. I'm happy to
answer
anything
else. Back to convener.
Thank you. Ben, I think you've got some questions.
Thank you, convener. Good morning. Building on what's already been said in response to colleagues, I just wanted to give you the chance to answer whether there are other areas of the bill, such as proposed powers for waste and surplus reporting by business, which could be used to support those sustainable consumer choices that you talked about. For example, by making information about environmental impacts more transparent and accessible. And in generality, really, what information do consumers need to make sustainable choices? And to what extent is that information currently available?
The question around reporting surpluses is not one that has previously occurred to me. It's probably one that Zero Waste Scotland would be better equipped to answer. At a very broad level, yes, having that type of information available would help identify where surpluses were and whether further action needed to be taken. I'm sure that your previous panels would also tell you that you needed to be mindful of the burden of reporting requirements as well. So I would probably defer to any thoughts that Zero Waste Scotland might have. In that respect, I'm sorry, you asked me, there was a second limb to the question that you asked me.
It's what information do consumers need to make sustainable choices? I mean, feeding into what Mr. Stewart also said about, you know, people are busy, they've got other things on their mind, you know, let's put ourselves in the shoes of the consumer. What information do they need? And to what extent is information currently available that can be highlighted?
It's difficult, and I think it's confusing. In all honesty, many of us want to make the right decisions, but it's very difficult to judge green claims. And I know that the Competition and Markets Authority and the Advertising Standards Agency is continuing to work on the issue of greenwashing to ensure that consumers can expect transparent and accurate information. Generally, consumers need reliable and trustworthy information. You need to be able to have a sense of how long something is going to last and whether that is value for money. A sense of whether, if you're buying a longer life item, that item is able to be repaired or not. You need to be able to understand labelling. So if you're buying textiles and it says something about sustainability, what metrics are employed in that? Are those metrics trustworthy? You need and also information about repairing, recycling. You know, recycling labels in themselves can be quite confusing. It can be difficult to know whether something is able to be recycled, particularly when there are different arrangements in place across different local authorities. So those are the types of information that I can think of that would help consumers in the moment make a more sustainable choice. I don't know whether there's anything else from our report, Fraser, you'd want to highlight.
What is coming through in our research is that consumers tell us that they want the information. But it needs to be understandable information, and it needs to be something that they can put into action. So it's not a case of on the back of all products, there just being an extensive list of unfathomable information that has no bearing into what facilities are available in the local community. So but the message though that we are getting is that people want to know more, but it needs to be simple and information that they can then put into practice that fits in with their family life. So it's not just about, what we're trying to get across is it's not just about providing huge amounts of information to people and then leaving it to them to make up their mind about whether it's something they can do or how do they go about it. It needs to be, that it needs to be appropriate information delivered in the right way at the right time, and then that allows people to then see themselves as part of the solution.
And building on that, you said in your written evidence that the new consumer duty will likely be relevant to measures under the bill, the Circular Economy Bill, including strategic decisions on waste infrastructure and targets. I'd just be grateful if you could expand on this and how the new duty could interact with the new circular economy regulation if passed, and how can the guidance support best practice in that situation?
The consumer duty will come into force at the end of this year. We do have a statutory power to issue guidance to public authorities under that, and that guidance has to be approved by Scottish ministers. Regulations designating the bodies that it will apply to will also be laid by the Scottish Government nearer to that time. We are working on that guidance at the moment, but it will effectively require public bodies to consider consumer interests when they take strategic decisions. Now, that might apply, for example, to provision of recycling schemes. It might apply to considerations about local businesses and how they support local businesses and what the priorities are in that respect. Until we have that guidance, which is still being worked on, it's difficult to know in practice. However, and there will be, I should say, a one-year period of implementation before that really begins to be being enforced. But there are opportunities to bring consumer needs closer to the top of that agenda, if you like, to ensure that the needs of consumers are considered more as part of that decision making rather than just the convenience or the operational nature of those decisions. We think that there are opportunities to help just again streamline things so that consumers aren't the last thing to be thought of at the end of those processes, and that's built in much more from the start. We are also talking to the government about how, for example, that consumer duty approach will integrate with some of the impact assessments that are already being made, and with some of the business impact assessments as well. So we would hope that we can begin to develop just a more coherent approach to all of these things through integrating those different sources of information.
Thank you. And just finally, are there any other comments you would like to make on the bill that you haven't had the opportunity to state or emphasise through answers to all our questions today?
I don't think so. I think really the things that our plea would be for consumers to be thought about as part of these processes and for consumer needs to be thought about, that involves having consistent messaging, that involves thinking about whether there are accessible and affordable alternatives and how those alternatives can be delivered, particularly to those consumers who might be vulnerable. Those are the things that we would really like to highlight to the committee at this stage. We do think that the bill will provide a significant opportunity for dealing with some of those issues. But the strategy will be crucial in aligning what is a very, very complicated landscape and in trying to ensure that the different layers within that landscape are actually sitting in harmony.
I think such important points, not just the affordability, which of course is significantly pertinent, but also accessibility, being able to actually transport yourself to where alternatives are available and facilities are available is certainly something that's on my mind.
I think we need to learn lessons from previous things that have been done, particularly when it comes to single-use plastics and charging and banning, and that we have examples of things like single-use cutlery being banned. We know that, for example, that caused in its initial stages some implications for disability groups in terms of having unintended consequences, and those were addressed and were dealt with. Again, we know that we've got relatively successful introduction of the plastic carrier bag charging, and we've got lessons that can be learned from that in terms of communities understanding why this charge is being brought in, what effect it will have, and also what's being done with the money that is being generated under those schemes. So there's some really good lessons that are out there that can be drawn on from previous things we've done. It's just about taking those into account in the design of any new schemes.
Taking people with you effectively.
Exactly.
Yeah. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Thank you. Sarah, I think you have some brief questions.
It was just in paragraph 21 of your report, you talk about the need for, or a suggestion for, legal targets on the transportation and packaging of goods. And I was just wondering if you want to comment on that. There's obviously a huge amount of Scotland is rural, with a huge increase in packages being delivered during the pandemic. And I just wanted to comment on how do you think you would actually see those targets? You're saying mandatory reporting of transport emissions. That would obviously raise awareness, but just how would you do that, or how should the government do that? Thank you.
It's a difficult one because as consumers, we've all become very accustomed to being able to hit the yes, next day delivery at no extra cost button when we order goods. And I think there will be some work to do to test consumer perceptions of whether they are willing to consider different alternatives, whether that be grouping deliveries into batches, whether that be using parcel lockers, whether that be looking at aggregating deliveries and potentially looking at things like integrating parcel deliveries with other things that are already in there. We know that this happens in the Highlands, for example. We will be doing some research, and I don't know whether there's anything Fraser can add on that in relation to looking at consumer attitudes to decarbonisation later this year. And that's one of the issues that we would want to test out, is that kind of delivery charging model and how consumers feel about that and what potential there is for change in a sustainable sense.
Yeah, don't have much to add on that other than our post-policy team is commissioning an attitude survey this year that will be looking at, as Tracy says, decarbonisation of the parcel sector, to try and get on top of in a bit more detail than we were able to do in our survey work, get on top of the detail in relation to the issues specifically around decarbonisation in the postal or the parcels market.
Right, that's useful. Just the timing is the bill is ongoing now, so you'd be moving towards potentially amendment stage. So it'll be useful for the committee, I think, to be kept updated with that issue. Thank you.
Thank you. If there's no other questions, I've just got one at the end. As advocates on behalf of consumers and representing consumer interests, in your written evidence you said it would be beneficial for strategies to be aligned as much as possible with strategies from other UK nations. Now, one of the things that we've got to understand when it comes to this bill is whether there are going to be any problems with the internal market and what happens. So what are your views? Is it all clear-cut, simple, no conflict, or is there potential areas which we should be looking out at?
I think the Office of Internal Markets is relatively new still, so it is still challenging to really ascertain what the implications of that office will be. We know that trade between the UK nations is certainly important in economic terms, and we know that in carrying out that trade, businesses are going to be looking for certainty, clarity, and consistency. Generally speaking, businesses, I think, are still reporting that trade is working well within the UK nations. It's also, I think, if you look at the recent annual report from the Office of Internal Markets, I think it's important to recognise that it's only a minority of UK businesses that do trade within the nations. I think where requests under the Internal Markets Act are put forward, probably the key factor that we think can influence the success or otherwise of those measures is very early engagement. I think all we would want to say is that we would urge that the implications of any decisions for consumers and small businesses are identified at quite an early stage during those intergovernmental discussions and are considered as part of the assessment process.
It just strikes me that if targets and regulation are placed on products up here and not south of the border, it's not that inconvenient to make sure that you don't have to pay the extra costs that may be incurred by buying them in Scotland. Do you think that's a realistic issue?
I think it's too early for us to tell what business behaviour will be as a result of the operation of the Internal Markets Office at this stage. It may be that the Office of Internal Markets itself is in a better position to answer that. We would not have any evidence either way.
But you would encourage early dialogue?
We would encourage early dialogue and we would encourage identification of the implications for consumers and small businesses, both financial and otherwise.
And that... Oh, I was going to say that was a perfect point to end, but Mark's going to trump me on that. Mark?
It just inspired a further question. I mean, from your view, as you know, regulatory innovation from devolved administrations, has that been useful in this space? So you talked earlier on about... you know, single-use plastics, you know, carrier bag charges. I mean, there is the issue about, you know, the operation of an internal market. But what's your kind of assessment of policy innovation?
Well, it's been a bad thing to have some nations taking the lead. And I think that the legislation does recognise, I think, that there are times when governments might want to diverge in order to reflect more local needs or in order to reflect... differing strategic priorities within the nations. There are certainly things that have been done by one nation that have then gone on to be adopted by other nations once they've seen how it works. I'm thinking that there were measures that Wales put forward, for example, that have then been adopted, and peat-free compost and other such detailed things as the OIAB have been considering. So it can lead certainly to the development of later, more UK-wide solutions that are based on seeing how things have worked in practice in one of the nations, or at least ensure that where divergence is developing, it is based on an evidence base and
a set of
priorities.
Does that outweigh any potential, you know, confusion from consumers, where they may go to Wales and go, I didn't realise that this wasn't on sale, you know, because it's been banned or whatever. I mean, is that...
A difficult to speculate on at a kind of more general level. I think you'd have to be looking at an individual measure to be able to say how much confusion or otherwise that would cause. It's probably more difficult for businesses. And that if they are operating on a UK-wide level, they need to be able to plan and they need certainty to encourage that planning. But as we know, not every business is going to trade either within Europe or within the UK. So it's difficult to give a very broad answer in that respect.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. A very useful session, and we're now at the end of it. So thank you very much for coming along today and sitting through both sessions and answering more questions, I think, in the last session. So very helpful for us. I'm going to suspend the meeting. Well, in fact, we're not. I think we're moving into... Yeah, we're going into a private session. So I'm not suspending it. We're just going to move into private session. Thank you very much.